First, giving honor to God, our Creator, and the great men, women, and children who came before us, who dedicated their lives so that we may have a better life. All right, this is going to be a process here that we go through. Relax, take your time, and sometimes this is an educational experience here. The series, this is a product of the University in Your Home series. I shouldn't have to charge you $40,000 a year in order for you to think that an education is valuable. And the process that we're going through, what we want to do is start from the beginning. So we want to start from zero so we can rebuild and deprogram and give you the tools as necessary to have a vibrant and productive life. And not only that, being able to work with your brother or your sister in a constructive way. And a lot of things here, you may say, well, I already know that. That's a barrier to knowledge, and that's one of the problems that we're going to address today. Just because you know something, unless you use it constructively, knowledge is power only if put to use. So let's learn to work together and open up our minds. One of the problems that we have is that we can't listen to each other, we can't learn from each other, and especially those people who've spent their lives getting the education and the knowledge, and those who haven't even basically graduated from high school, can't listen and learn to anyone else. You know, there's a chasm here that needs to be crossed. So the ones who have experienced life, and we can learn from each other no matter who you are. The life experience that you have in the so-called streets and the hood is valuable information, common sense, experiences, and we all have inherent gifts that are valuable to one another. So, and our young people with fresh minds, so they won't fall into the traps and we can recondition ourselves. So we want to deprogram. In order to deprogram, we need to understand what we're up against and what was done. It's an amazing thing, and it's not normal for people to not be able to work together. It's just not normal. So that means that there's a sickness in the land when we can't talk to each other, we can't learn from each other. And I have to charge you an extraordinary amount of money and put you in debt the rest of your life in order for you to learn something or go through a process. Or at the end of the rainbow is just fiction. And one of the words that I run across, one of the things that we have been taught in this country, from the church to our systems of the way we conduct ourselves, is malarkey. A lot of it is a bunch of malarkey. And I put together a series of educational presentations, this starting the beginning of this process, so that we can deprogram. And this one is the Willie Lynch letter, The Making of a Slave. It would be humorous if it wasn't so serious. So let's slow down, let's relax for a moment. Bring your flat families around so that way we can start to deprogram and debrief ourselves and start to address these issues and fight real hard to, especially our women. You know, our strong women. Our nation runs through our women. And if our women are screwed up and can't listen, then our nation is going to be screwed up. So it's very important for our women to pay attention and to take these matters into heart. You know, we're too caught up in our hair and our nails and how we want to have the nicest things in our home, materialism. If we can slow down for a moment and break down ourselves and build up, then these things will come naturally. All right? The Willie Lynch letter, The Making of a Slave. And first thing what we want to do, let's go through the process. Let's remember who we are. Ashe, and it's so. So let's go through this process and let's look at these slides and let's let our minds wander again, and then we'll start with the process of the Willie Lynch letter. But let's meditate for a moment. the civilization, ancient Egyptian civilization, was 10,000 years plus. They even have documentation, 50,000 years of first mathematics. And the book of Genesis didn't started dated back to year 5,000, 4,000 BCE. That was in the middle of the Egyptian Empire, beginning to decline. And the Genesis portion is when the European began to come onto the scene. So they made that the beginning for their own creation. But we have another series on that we will address. Let's say focus on the deprogramming aspect right now. What great architecture. Robbed the graves, isn't that something? Went in there and robbed the graves. Came into Africa and stole. The pyramids used to be wrapped in gold, bands of gold, and they took everything and put it in the trucks and basically shipped Africa out in trucks. Deep dismantled it. Great Moors. We're going to talk about that historical aspect as well. Our conquerors. And I learned that they have they've isolated the conqueror gene, the African conqueror gene, and the conquered gene. So they have the DNA from the conquerors, from African conquerors, and the conquered. Isn't that something? First Pope being black, St. Peter. And that's what our great prophets of the past, you will be even greater. John 14:12, he said, you will be even greater. So in the religions today, we're stagnant. You know, I've looked at a program the other day on a television station where they selling miracle mixes, and it was full of black folks. It's unbelievable. We want everything given to us. We think of the hocus pocus mysticism, but we won't do anything for ourselves. We won't come together. Other, we just want people to give us mystical stuff. We believe in stuff that is not based upon sound logic or reason, or even sound science. It's unbelievable. And if you believe in Jesus being God, the Son of God, he said you will even be greater. You will do even greater things than I. So that makes you a God as well. And we must be willing to work together and put our life down for each other. That's the only way that we're going to rebuild our civilization and people so we can live in peace. The European only respects strength. So you can't deal from weakness. And the first slave ship was called Jesus of Lubeck. So they take stuff and twist it in and give us a bunch of malarkey that we don't even have the logic, the reasoning ability, the thinking ability to dissect fact from fiction. And our parents and our mothers have to wake up and quit training and teaching our children nonsense. And we're going to learn that. This is the first president, the real first president of these United States. They're called the Confederate States, or it wasn't the United States. So the first five presidents were black. And then they, because they changed the name of the country, they took those names out. And just because others hate us don't mean we should hate ourselves. Together we stand, divided we fall. We all should be leaders. We want to put leadership in each one of our households. Each individual must become a leader. Let's quit relying on individuals to come and save us. We have to save ourselves. As Jesus said, you will even do greater things than I. That's individual responsibility. And these men of greatness came to wake us up, but yet we still sleepwalk. Let's walk into our greatness, each individual. And our mothers, please, our sisters, our strong sisters, you're the foundation. If it wasn't for us, and even in ancient Egypt, we will see it's the black woman that was the foundation. Birth comes from us. We love you. You know, we don't denigrate you and put you in the back scenes like the European race does to their women. And quit trying to be like them. We cannot be great being something that we're not. Step into your greatness. No, our young men are being destroyed. They're going to prison. They're being feminized. Black women, come on. Quit kicking out your black men. In church, crying for a man. But when you get a man, you chew him up and spit him out. Let's break this last bond of slaveriness. You know, the revolution will not be televised because it will take place in our minds. So let's look at the Willie Lynch letter, The Making of a Slave. This speech was delivered by Willie Lynch on the bank of the James River in the colony of Virginia in 1712. Lynch was a British slave owner in the West Indies. He was invited to the colony of Virginia in 1712 to teach his methods to slave owners there. The term lynching is derived from his last name. Greetings, gentlemen. I greet you here on the bank of the James River in the year of our Lord, 1712. First, I shall thank you, the gentlemen of the colony of Virginia, for bringing me here. I am here to help you solve some of your problems with slaves. Your invitation reached me on my modest plantation in the West Indies, where I have experimented with some of the newest and still the oldest methods for control of slaves. Ancient Rome would envy us if my program is implemented. As our boat sails south on the James River, named for our illustrious king, whose version of the Bible we cherish, I saw enough to know that your problem is not unique. While Rome used cords of wood and as crosses for standing human bodies along its highways in great numbers, you are here using the tree and the rope on occasions. I caught the whiff of a dead slave hanging from a tree a couple miles back. You are not only losing valuable stock by hangings, you are having uprisings. Slaves are running away. Your crops are sometimes left in the field too long for maximum profit. You suffer occasional fires. Your animals are killed. Gentlemen, you know what your problems are. I do not need to elaborate. I am not here to enumerate your problems. I am here to introduce you to a method of solving them. In my bag here, I have a foolproof method for controlling your black slaves. I guarantee every one of you that, if installed correctly, it will control the slaves for at least 300 years. My method is simple. Any member of your family or your overseer can use it. I have outlined a number of differences among the slaves, and I take these differences and make them bigger. I use fear, distrust, and envy for control purposes. These methods have worked on my modest plantation in the West Indies, and it will work throughout the South. Take this simple little list of differences and think about them. On top of my list of A is age, but is there only because it starts with an A. The second is color or shade. There is intelligence, size, sex, sizes of plantations, status on plantations, attitude of owners, whether the slaves live in a valley, on a hill, east, west, north, south, have fine hair, coarse hair, or is tall or short. Now that you have a list of these differences, I shall give you an outline of action. But before that, I shall assure you that distrust is stronger than trust, and envy stronger than adulation, respect, or admiration. The black slaves, after receiving this indoctrination, shall carry on and will become self-refueling and self-generating for hundreds of years, maybe thousands. It's been already 400 years since the first African landed on these shores in 1716. Don't forget, you must pitch the old black male versus the young black male, and the young black male against the old black male. You must use the dark-skinned slaves versus the light-skinned slaves, and the light-skinned slaves versus the dark-skinned slaves. You must use the female versus the male, and the male versus the female. You must also have white servants and overseers who distrust all blacks. But it is necessary that your slaves trust and depend on us. They must love, respect, and trust only us. Gentlemen, these kits are your keys to control. Use them. Have your wives and children use them. Never miss an opportunity. If used intensely for 1 year, the slaves themselves will remain perpetually distrustful. Thank you, gentlemen. You think about these things, and that's why unity is so important. That's why love is so important. Understanding, compassion, the grace and mercy that you show your brother or sister is the same grace and mercy that God's going to use against you on judgment. And we're going to make the crooked road straight. We're going to go through this process. So I'm going to have a series of lectures and presentations on PowerPoint, so we can slowly go through these things, so we can correct ourselves. And you must use your energy and your strength, because this is like a terrible disease, an addiction that must be overcome. And it's something that must not be taken lightly. In our churches, the gossiping, the bickering, the cliques, the giving the pastors a hard time, there's always a group of troublemakers. We have to stop that. It is important. because we are on a journey, a spiritual journey. And you have to prepare yourself, not only in this life, because we're going to be judged. If you can't get along in this life, this is the testing grounds. Because he wants to see how you're going to conduct yourselves on this life to see if you make the team in the next life. So it's very important, people, that we humble ourselves, we open up our minds and hearts, and that we change. It took us generations of breeding and indoctrination to get to this point. But God gave us minds to use and to think with in order for us to make changes. And that's why this ministry is so important. We're starting from the grassroots, the bottom, and we're going to reconstruct ourselves. Now let's go through some various outline. We have a few pages to go through here. So we can deconstruct this thing, so let's look at it critically. We have several areas to go through. So the first one is it talks about how to make a slave. The cardinal principles for making a Negro. The breaking process of the African woman. The Negro marriage. Warning possible interloping negatives. Controlling the language. And crossbreeding. And then the final note. Let's make a slave. It was the interest and business of slaveholders to study human nature. And the slave nature in particular, with a view to practical results. I and many of them attained astonishing proficiency in this direction. They had to deal not with earth, wood, and stone, but with men, and by every regard they had for their own safety and prosperity, they needed to know the material in which they were to work. Conscious of the injustice and wrong they were every hour perpetuating, and knowing what they themselves would do. Were they the victims of such wrongs? They were constantly looking for the first signs of the dreaded retribution. They watched, therefore, with skilled and practiced eyes and learned to read with great accuracy the state of mind and heart of the slave through his sable face, unusual sobriety, apparent abstractions, sullenness and indifference indeed. Any mood out of the common was afforded ground for suspicion and inquiry. Frederick Douglass, Let's Make a Slave, is a study of the scientific process of man-breaking and slave-making. It describes the rationale and results of the Anglo-Saxons' ideas and methods of ensuring the master-slave relationship. Let's Make a Slave, the original and development of a social being called the Negro. Let us make a slave. What do we need? First of all, we need a black nigger man, a pregnant nigger woman, and her baby nigger boy. Second, we will use the same basic principle that we use in breaking a horse, combined with some more sustaining factors. What we do with horses is that we break them from one form of life to another. That is, we reduce them from their natural state in nature. Whereas nature provides them with the natural capacity to take care of their offspring, we break that natural string of independence from them and thereby create a dependency status, so that way we may be able to get from them useful production for our business and pleasure. Cardinal principles for making a Negro. For fear that our future generations may not understand the principles of breaking both of the beasts together, the nigger and the horse, we understand that short-range planning economics results in periodic economic chaos. The business cycles. Periodic economic chaos. It sounds like the recessions and so forth. Put us in check. So that to avoid turmoil in the economy, it requires us to have breadth and depth in long-range comprehensive planning, articulating both skilled, sharp perceptions. We lay down the following principles for long-range comprehensive economic planning. Both horse and niggers are no good to the economy in the wild or natural state. Both must be broken and tied together for orderly production. For orderly future, special and particular attention must be paid to the female and the youngest offspring. Both must be crossbred to produce a variety and division of labor. Both must be taught to respond to a particular new language. Psychological and physical instructions of containment must be created for both. We hold the six cardinal principles as truth to be self-evident, based upon the following: the discourse concerning the economics of breaking and tying the horse and the nigger together, all inclusive of the six principles laid down above. Note, neither principle done alone suffice for good economics or economics. All principles must be employed for orderly good of the nation. Accordingly, both a wild horse and a wild or natural nigger is dangerous, even if captured, for they will have the tendency to seek their customary freedom, and in doing so might kill you in your sleep. You cannot rest. They sleep while you are awake, and are awake while you are asleep. They are dangerous near the family house, and it requires too much labor to wash them away from the house. Above all, you cannot get them to work in this natural state. Hence, both the horse and the nigger must be broken. That is, breaking them from one form of mental life to another. Keep the body, take the mind. In other words, break the will to resist. Now, the breaking process is the same for both the horse and the nigger, only slightly varying in degrees. But, as we said before, there is an art in long-range economic planning. You must keep your eye and thoughts on the female and the offspring of the horse and the nigger. A brief discourse in offspring development will shed light on the key to sound economic principles. Pay little attention to the generation of original breaking, but concentrate on future generations. Therefore, if you break the female mother, she will break the offspring in its early years of development. And when the offspring is old enough to work, she will deliver it up to you. For her normal female protective tendencies will have been lost in the original breaking process. For example, take the case of the wild stud horse. A female horse and an already infant horse, and compare the breaking process with two captured nigger males in their natural state. A pregnant nigger woman with her infant offspring. Take the stud horse. Break him for limited containment. Completely break the female horse until she becomes very gentle, whereas you or anybody can ride her in her comfort. Breed the mare and the stud until you have the desired offspring. Then, you can turn the stud to freedom until you need him again. Train the female horse, whereby she will eat out of your hand. And she will in turn train the infant horse to eat out of your hand also. When it comes to breaking the uncivilized nigger, use the same process, but vary the degrees and step up the pressure so as to do a complete reversal of the mind. Take the meanest and most restless nigger, strip him of his clothes in front of the remaining male niggers. The female and the nigger infant, tar and feather him. Tie each leg to a different horse facing opposite directions. Set him afire and beat both horses to pull him apart in front of the remaining niggers. The next step is to take a bull whip and beat the remaining nigger males to the point of death in front of the female and the infant. Don't kill him, but put the fear of God in him, for he can be useful for future breeding. The breaking process of the African woman. Take the female and run a series of tests on her to see if she will submit to your desires willingly. Test her in every way, because she is the most important factor for good economics. If she shows any sign of resistance and submitting completely to your will, Do not hesitate to use the bullwhip on her to extract that last bit of bitch out of her. Take care not to kill her, for in doing so, you spoil good economics. When in complete submission, she will train her offspring in the early years to submit to labor when they become of age. Understanding is the best thing. Therefore, we shall go deeper into this area of the subject matter concerning what we have produced here in this breaking process of the female nigger. We have reversed the relationship. In her natural uncivilized state, she would have a strong dependency on the uncivilized nigger male, and she would have a limited protective tendency toward her independent male offspring, and would raise male offsprings to be dependent like her. Nature had provided for this type of balance. We reverse nature by burning and pulling a civilized nigger apart and bullwhooping the other to the point of death, all in her presence. By her being left alone, unprotected, with the male image destroyed, the ordeal caused her to move from her psychologically dependent state to a frozen, independent state. In this frozen psychological state of independence, she will raise her male and female offspring in reverse roles. My Lord, that's what's happening today. Strong young females and feminine young males. For fear of the young male's life, she will psychologically train him to be mentally weak and dependent, but physically strong. Because she has become psychologically dependent, she will train her female offsprings to be psychologically independent. That's exactly what's happening today. What have you got? You've got the nigger woman out front and the nigger man behind and scared. This is a perfect situation of sound sleep and economics. Before the breaking process, we had to be alertly on guard at all times. Now, we can sleep soundly. For out of frozen fear, his woman stands guard for us. He cannot get past her early slave molding process. He is a good tool, now ready to be tied to the horse at a tender age. By the time a nigger boy reaches the age of 16, he is soundly broken in and ready for a long life of sound and efficient work and the reproduction of a unit of good labor force. Continually through the breaking of uncivilized savage niggers, by throwing the nigger female savage into a frozen psychological state of independence, by killing the protective male image, and by creating a submissive, dependent mind of the nigger male slave, we have created an orbiting cycle that turns on its own axis forever, unless a phenomenon occurs and reshifts the position of the male and female slaves. That's what we're talking about now, a phenomenon that's occurring. We show what we mean by example. Take the case of the two economic slave units and examine them close. The Negro marriage. We breed two nigger males with two nigger females. Then we take the nigger male away from them and keep them moving and working. Say one nigger female bears a nigger female and the other bears a nigger male. Both nigger females, being without influence of the nigger male image, frozen with an independent psychology, will raise their offspring into reverse positions. The one with the female offspring will teach her to be like herself, independent and negotiable. We negotiate with her, through her, by her, negotiates her at will. The one with the nigger male offspring, she being frozen subconscious fear for his life, will raise him to be mentally dependent and weak, but physically strong. In other words, body over mind. Now, in a few years, when these two offspring become fertile for early reproduction, we will mate and breed them and continue the cycle. That is good, sound, and long-range comprehensive planning. It's happening today. It's working. Warning: possible interloping negatives. Earlier, We talked about the non-economic good of the horse and the nigga in the wild or natural state. We talked out the principle of breaking and tying them together for orderly production. Furthermore, we talked about paying particular attention to the female savage and her offspring for orderly future planning. Then more recently, we stated that by reversing the positions of the male and female savages, we create an orbiting cycle that turns on its own axis forever, unless a phenomenon occurred and reshifts positions of the male and female savages. Our experts warn us about the possibility of this phenomenon occurring, for they say that the mind has a strong drive to correct and recorrect itself over a period of time if it can touch some substantial original historical base. That's what I'm trying to do here. Substantial original historical base, and I didn't even have to read this in order for me to know that this process has to be done. And they advise us that the best way to deal with the phenomenon is to shave off the brute's mental history and create a multiplicity of phenomena of illusions so that each illusion will twirl in its own orbit, something similar to floating balls in a vacuum. That's why they give you that New Testament scripture with Paul's teachings, you know, to trick you and to tell you. And even in the scriptures, we'll get to that. He's saying it's a lie. It's even in writing. That's why you have so many versions, because once they read the King James Version and realize that that there's truth in there, that once you learn how to read, then the trick is off. They come up with all these different versions to obscure it, so those who are not critical thinkers will never know the truth. And this system and the phenomena of breaking through this illusion will never occur. This creation of multiplicity of phenomena, of illusions, entails the principle of crossbreeding the nigga and the horse, as we stated above, the purpose of which is to create a diversified division of labor, thereby creating different levels of labor and different values of illusion at each connecting level of labor, the results of which is the severance of the points of original beginning for each sphere illusion. Since we feel that the subject matter may get more complicated as we proceed in laying down our economic plan concerning the purpose, reason, and effect of cross-breeding horses and niggers, we shall lay down the following definition terms for future generations. Orbiting cycle means a thing turning in a given path. Axis means upon which or around which a body turns. Phenomenon means something beyond ordinary conception and inspires awe and wonder. Multiplicity means a great number, means a globe. Crossbreeding a horse means taking a horse and breeding it with an ass, and you get a dumb, backward ass, long-headed mule that is not reproductive nor productive by itself. Crossbreeding niggers mean taking so many drops of good white blood and putting them into as many nigger women as possible. Varying the drops by the various tone that you want, and then letting them breed with each other until another circle of color appears as you desire. What this means is this. Put the niggers and the horse in a breeding pot. Mix some asses and some good white blood, and what do you get? You got a multiplicity of colors of ass backward, unusual niggers, running, tied to backward ass, long-headed mules, the one productive of itself, the other sterile. The one constant, the other dying. We keep the nigger constant, for we may replace the mules for another tool, both mule and nigger tied to each other, neither knowing where the other came from and neither productive for itself nor without each other. My Lord. Controlled language. Crossbreeding completed, for further severance from their original beginning, we must completely annihilate the mother tongue of both the new nigger and the new mule, and institute a new language that involves the new life's work of both. You know, language is a peculiar institution. It leads to the heart of a people. The more a foreigner knows about the language of another country, the more he is able to move through all levels of that society. Therefore, if the foreigner is an enemy of the country, to the extent that he knows the body of the language, to that extent is the country vulnerable to attack or invasion of a foreign culture. For example, if you take a slave, if you teach him all about your language, he will know all your secrets, and he is then no more slave. For you can't fool him any longer. And being a fool is one of the basic ingredients of any incidents to the maintenance of the slavery system. That's why they don't want our young men to be educated. They miseducate them, send them to jail. We're walking around, we can't talk to each other, we can't get along because we can't read, we can't spell. And they say, put it in the book because they can't read it. And that's what this whole educational process is about, so we can slowly come out of this and get an education. And I'm not charging you $40,000 a year for this process. A university in your home, buy the packet, $40 a month, just to get it going. Come on, people. For example, and then we can start building businesses and industry and recycling dollars within our community and putting the woman and the male back in the places that they should be, both needing each other to be strong, instead of one tearing down the other. And our young men, you can see tonight, we're producing a generation of effeminate young men walking around with their pants down. No man in the house. For example, if you told a slave that he must perform in getting out our crops, and he knows the language well, he would know that our crops didn't mean our crops, and that the slavery system would break down. Or he would relate on the basis of what our crops really meant. So if you have to be careful in setting up the new language, for the slaves would soon be in your house, talking to you as man to man, and that is death to our economic system. In addition, the definitions of words or terms are only a minute part of the process. Values are created and transported by communication through the body of the language. A total society has many interconnected value systems. All the values in the society have bridges of language to connect them for orderly working in the society. But for these language bridges, these many value systems will sharply clash and cause internal strife or civil war. The degree of conflict being determined by the magnitude of the issues or relative opposing strength in whatever form. For example, if you put a slave in a hog pen and trained him to live there and incorporated him to value it as a way of life completely, the biggest problem you would have out of him is that he would worry you about provisions to keep the hog pen clean, or the same hog pen and make a slip and incorporate something in his language whereby he comes to value a house more than he does his hog pen. You got a problem. He will soon be in your house. Additional note. Henry Barry, speaking in the Virginia House of Delegates in 1832, described the situation as it existed in many parts of the South at this time. We have, as far as possible, close every avenue by which light may enter the slaves' minds. If we could extinguish the capacity to see the light, our work would be complete. They would then be on the level with the beasts of the field and we would be safe. I am not certain that we would not do it if we could find out the process, and that on the plea of necessity. The Story of a New Race by Edwin R. Embry, 1931, The Viking Press. Let's take a break.